seriously?
Dawn French continues the story of Daisy Pig at 4:10, and Fantastic Max heads for another adventure at 4:25. Money is the topic in Ipso Facto at 4:35, with Newsround at 5, and Grange Hill at 10:10. Here on 2 now, in the first of a new series, Hawk's Eye, Mena Roberts introduces the adventures of a river on the way to the sea.
Water canoeing, that's what they call it, this exciting way of travelling down a river. But you've got to be tough as old boots to do it.
Well, that's certainly not for me. I like to sit back and let other people do all the work. Come on, Simon, we've got a long way to go.
Okay, Mother.
Ah, yes. This is much more to my taste than shooting the waterfall.
But just what makes a river change its mood, its personality? Well, we're going to find out together. And there's only one place to start, isn't there? And you know where that is. Yes, back in those hills.
All our bigger rivers in Wales have their beginnings in the mountains. But they never begin as they intend to go on. And even the narrowest brook can be seen to get wider as it makes its way down the valley. But the speed of its progress changes with every change in the slope of the hill. But sometimes, even the youngest river can play an unexpected trick on anybody trying to follow its tracks. Believe it or not, Dyfed Ellis Griffith has lost our river. Where could it have gone to, do you think?
Usually, it's not possible to walk along a stream bed without getting your feet thoroughly wet. But in this area, the impossible is possible. Here, the bed of the River Mechte is as dry as a bone throughout the year. But believe it or not, the river still flows beneath my feet. In fact, if you listen very, very carefully, you can hear the sound of running water, although you can't see the river anywhere around me. And here it is, the River Mechte, one of a number of streams in this area which like to play tricks on us, or at least they like to play hide-and-seek with the rocks. And one of their favourite games is to disappear underground and follow caves. But before I venture down that hole and try and follow the stream any further, I'm going to wear a hard hat on my head and grab hold of a torch, because caves can be very dangerous places. Well, by now, the old river bed is high above my head, and I'm standing in the present river bed of the River Mechte. And believe you me, the water's very cold here. And it's not only the water that's cold, but it's the air around me that's cold. And that's why I'm very glad that I'm wearing this coat. Well, the next task is to follow the river, and hopefully we'll meet the other end. Bye for now. Here on the floor of Portorogov, there are hundreds and hundreds of red stones which are completely different to the dark grey rock around us. I wonder whether it's the river that's been responsible for sweeping these down valley and carrying the stones into the mouth of the cave. And over there, there's a large tree trunk that's been swept into the cave after a period of heavy rain during the winter. Well, here we are in Portorogov, which means the mouth of the cave. There's a whole system of caves here. One over there, one to my right. Some of them very big, others very small. Some of them are very wet, others then are bone dry. But all of them snake and twist their way through the dark grey rock around us, on their way down valley. I was about to have a piece of chocolate, but there you are. You've caught me in the act, haven't you? But you know as well as I do that if you eat too much sweet things, especially between your meals, you can do damage to your teeth. Why? Because some amount of the sugar in your mouth turns to acid, and the acid then attacks your teeth. It dissolves your teeth and creates little holes or cavities in your teeth, similar to caves. Cavities then that the dentist has to fill. Now your teeth are very similar to the grey rock around me, to the grey limestone. They are hard, like this grey limestone. Very hard. But on the other hand, this limestone, like your teeth, will dissolve when it's attacked by acid. Let's do a simple experiment. Here there's a piece of red stone. And here in this bottle, I've got a little bit of weak acid, and I'm going to put a drop of it on the red stone. Let's see what happens. Nothing. It wets the surface and does nothing else. But now I'm going to put a drop onto the limestone. Look at that. The acid is dissolving the limestone and creating that fizz on the surface of the rock. And that's how caves are formed, because in river water you've also got some amount of acid, and the acid dissolves the rock and it goes into cracks, widens them, and creates wider cracks, then small caves, and then larger caves like Portorogov.
Underground or overground, all rivers have to make their way downhill towards the sea. But why does this stream go over the rock to create a waterfall? Why hasn't it worn the rock away? Yes, that's right, because some rocks are harder than others, and the river will always choose the easier path. Usually, the river runs gently between well-defined banks, a danger to no one. But that can all change very suddenly. heavy rain in the hills can sometimes cause great trouble miles downstream. And not all the kittens were saved when the River Towy burst its banks recently. Farm animals caught grazing in the fields were lucky to flee the rising water. Floods like these are dangerous as well as costly and damaging to farms and villages in the river valley. So what can be done to prevent them? We can't change the weather, but with the right machinery, we can alter the course of the river. In this town, they're deepening the riverbed. Why do you think? Out of its bed, the river can be dangerous. And in every valley, you can spot what's being done to try to control the misbehaving water. Can you see the wire mesh wrapped around these stones? There must be a reason for that. A drastic way to control the river is to take some of its water right away. Cut another course for it, a course which has none of those natural obstacles which you find on every river. To sail quietly through the countryside, avoiding rocks, waterfalls, and rapids, calls for a canal. And alongside many of our fast-flowing rivers, you can often find a quiet, peaceful canal. Canals go up or down the valley in steps by means of locks, which take time and sweat to open and close. It's very, very slow, but very efficient. We'll get up there in the end. All over Wales, you can find old canals. Some of them very spectacular, like this one, high up in the air. The great aqueduct over the River Dee at Chirk was built to take water down to a larger canal in England. And over 100 years after it was built by the great engineer Thomas Telford, barges still use this bridge to cross the valley on their way by water to Llangollen. And this canal in South Wales was here long before the motorway. But you can see which carries most traffic today. The railway, like the road, follows the route of the canal and the river to the sea. But before the sea, there's a town. It's a very busy town, and it's here because of the river. The only trouble is that in this town, as in many others, there doesn't seem to be any sign of that river. One person who's having difficulty finding it is Dr. Ken Thomas.
Oh, excuse me, can you tell me where the river is?
The river? I think it's over there somewhere.
Over there?
Yeah, I think so.
I see. Is it important to you?
The river's not important to me at all, no.
It isn't, though?
No.
Oh, well. Oh, excuse me, can you tell me if the river is important?
It's not important at all.
You don't think so?
No.
Oh, well, thank you very much indeed.
It's okay.
He might know. No, not a clue. And that signpost wasn't much help. But here it is, tucked away when no one can see it. Out of sight, out of mind. But someone's used it. Look, an old wreck. And the salmon and sewin, They found it all right. But we build bridges over the river. I wonder if those people in that train think the river is important. I doubt it.
Who needs a river? But it wasn't always so. There was a time, years and years ago, when this river was really important. And without it, this town and many others like it all over Wales would not have been here at all. Furthermore, I can prove it. You just come with me.
Look over there, in between the supermarket and the multi-story car park. An old castle. The castle in Castellnedd. It was built by a Norman lord, Robert Fitzhamon, in the 12th century. From these battlements, his soldiers could keep an eye on the fort and everybody who used it to cross the river.
Robert Fitzhamon, the Norman Lord of Glamorgan, was no mug. He knew the importance of this river, and especially of its lowest crossing point.
Like the Severn Bridge crossing today, this ford at Neath was a very busy place. Ships used to tie up here.
Soon the castle was not the only building by the river. Other buildings appeared. In fact, there's one over there. That also, like the castle, is a ruin. But at one time, it was a very, very important place indeed.
Neath Abbey, where the white monks used to live and worship. They were farmers too. Sheep farmers, and much of the land around was theirs. They also made use of the river, and the ships are tied up nearby. On these ships, the wool of 1,000 sheep was sent overseas.
But that was centuries ago, and the townspeople have now largely turned their backs on the river. But the river was important. It helped to make the town what it is today. But all that is largely forgotten. And the river now flows gently past the back door on its way to the sea.
Well, I know now why they built that town 3 miles up the river from the sea. Just look at these sands. Do you think you could build anything at all here at the mouth of the river? This is a lonely, neglected place. Does it have any value at all, do you think?
Here in the classroom, we've been taking a closer look at rocks and the effect that acid, vinegar, has on them. How is a waterfall created? By using clay, some sand, and water from a plastic bottle, we made our own waterfall.